So the first person is Councillor Lena Simic, and this is her first speech, so once again, can we pay attention and be respectful? Thank you.
Thank you. This is an emergency, but as we also saw in this video, there are numerous opportunities. So this is also an opportunity. We can change, we must. This is an opportunity to smash neoliberalism because it simply doesn't work. Capitalism doesn't work, as our young speakers have told us and a number of other members here in these chambers. We don't break with the planet but with the system. Now, how do we do it? By democracy, by people's engagement, by listening, by creating citizens' assemblies, by acting, by our collective political will, and we here in the chamber are all responsible. We shall be held to account. 11 years and counting, it's up to us. Did we act? How? Were we fast enough? Now, I'm a proud member of the Labour Party, and I'm delighted that we actually have a plan. It's called Green Industrial Revolution. A just transition to low-carbon economy. So this is about rejigging the system away from profit and towards the people, and not only the people, but also the animals and the plants and all of the biodiversity of our planet Earth. We need to move quickly from our dependence on carbon, and yes, we are all addicts, to sustainability. And we can achieve that through another brilliant Labour Party policy, which is democratic public ownership. Let people own the natural resources, like the wind and the tide and the sun. These resources are fundamentally different from coal, oil and gas. We accept that you can own a piece of land under which there is oil or coal, but actually nobody owns the sunlight or the wind. It belongs to all of us and should be harnessed by and for all of us. Please let us remember that a huge amount of offshore wind is publicly owned. Burbo Bank, which is just near us, is actually owned by the Danish state. Orsted Company is a company in which Danish state has most of its shares, owns most of the shares. Wind and more wind farm off North Wales is part owned by the city of Munich. Why cannot city and people of Liverpool own the next set of wind farms that will be built in the bay over the coming years? Why cannot the Merseyside pension fund pay for this? Let us be ambitious. And of course, we work with the unions. We rely on the use of local labor in this green transformation. We rethink the way we organize the system and we live happier lives. We breathe in cleaner air. We breathe. The planet is ours to enjoy, not to exploit. Now or never we act. And the future exists in your imagination already. Young people told us here that it's happening now. So let's make it happen together. Breathe.
Take over an hour by road, but want to put away such as a large river. A city that starts looking at these new technologies now, engaging with these industries and planning the infrastructure that's needed, has a far greater chance of attracting the jobs and investment that will come with these innovations. But we also need to influence the way older established sectors develop in the city. Too often, our industrial parks are filled with not industries needing to be out of town, but offices and call centres staffed by workers who have no choice but to drive, and removing employment opportunities from those who can't or choose not to own a car. The public sector is also guilty of this. Hammond's in Merseyside's police headquarters will continue to use public transport after moving to Scotland Road and opening a current site next to a bus station. Meanwhile, most warehouses and distribution hubs are built only for road access. Most railway sidings have been lost to development over the years. But companies are now planning to reuse redundant passenger trains to restart parcel distribution by rail. And HS2 will increase capacity on the West Coast main line that can increase freight use. So let's see where we can protect land alongside our rail lines and direct new distribution hubs to locations where we have rail access, even if they might not want them at the moment. We might be worried about the effect of air travel, but data centres are on the verge of having a bigger carbon footprint than aviation. Much of this energy goes into cooling the equipment involved. In France, they're now building data parks that are cooled by water from deep lakes. Well, we've got a network of large and very cold docks that could be used for the same purpose. So in the future, let's look at ways to attract new green industries, but also let's try and zone the city better, directing businesses to locations that allow them to operate at the lowest possible carbon footprint.
Thank you. Councillor from Crone.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Can I also compliment Councillor Sirish on their excellent maiden speech, and also for the content of it, it was really radical thinking there. I think that speaks to the way we really need to reimagine industry in this country if we're going to have a true low carbon economy. Just referring to the video you just saw, I was actually rather disappointed to see Poseidon as a part of that video. I understand that they are a company that facilitate offsetting of carbon emissions. I think offset is a complete scam. We can't simply pay other countries to reduce their carbon emissions so that we can carry on emitting here in our own country. It completely misses the point. We need to come globally zero carbon and have any chance of averting a climate catastrophe. So I completely reject the idea of offset our emissions. We need to tackle our own problems and become truly zero carbon. So when it comes to reimagining and envisaging what a low carbon economy is, some things the Green Party has spoken about for a long time are also quite radical. For example, the concept of growth itself. I'm a growth agnostic. I mean, growth can be a good thing or a bad thing, but when we're trying to tackle the climate crisis, growth cannot be given priority over reducing carbon emissions. So if an opportunity to grow our local economy comes up that we can see that it directly contradicts our need to reduce carbon emissions, then we have to put the future of the planet ahead of growth. So growth is underneath tackling the climate crisis. Another Green Party policy that could be useful in reimagining what a low carbon economy might be like is our call for a four-day working week. Now, we all in this room think that people need work, people should be able to support their family by doing a day's work, but the obsession with 5 days a week means actually we have to, you know, the economy requires so much consumption, so much growth to be able to support all that work. So if the work was better shared out, we could have lower production, but everybody could be involved. So it's just a concept. Personally, I'd say a 3-day work would be even better. Think of all the time we could spend enjoying the fabulous arts and offering Liverpool and relaxing with our families. So I think these are things we should be looking at. Is there any way Liverpool could promote that within our own city? So obviously a big part of a low carbon economy will be renewable energy. If industry is powered by renewable energy, that would lead to it having a much lower impact on the environment. And this is an area where Liverpool really needs to turn to the government to demand change, because recent changes to the solar power tariff have completely gutted that industry. They didn't just cut the subsidy element, they stopped paying a fair price for electricity to go into the grid, which means that people who install solar panels are getting less money than coal-fired power stations. So that's just completely unfair and ridiculous. So there needs to be some form of subsidy feed-in tariff to reignite the solar power industry. And there are hopeful sounds about a possible change on policy on onshore wind, so that would be possible again. So these are the things we need to be lobbying government for as a council. We need to be selective about the businesses we want.
Can we start winding up, please?
Sure. Okay.
Thank you.
A good example of a business that we should promote in the city is we need to have an in-house company that is retrofitting properties which are in the walls and put better heating systems. A bad example is the cruise industry with all the associated arm and houses.
Thank you. Councillor Ryan.
What's been quite interesting is we've set all of us a direction that is not, these are not one-off, these have got to be sustainable things, that the decisions that we take that will change the way that we operate from the council, on the way that people will work, the kind of transport that we'll have in the city, and it's going to be quite challenging. But I would like to see the select committees and subcommittee come up with really good practical ideas and solutions that can start that process that will become embedded as we move forward as a council in the years ahead. I'd also like to see the select committee to not just focus on the council, because there's a lot of other organisations in the city and private ones that also need to be brought to account by the only democratic accountable body in the city, which is us, for the kind of things that they're doing and kind of measures that they're going to take. But I'd like to just when we do this, I'd like to sort of take on board some of the principles that some of the members have been talking about tonight. And then one of them, which has been mentioned a couple of times, is poverty. And I think that if we've got an opportunity of creating new jobs, and there are opportunities in the low carbon economy, then they have to be good jobs, and we have to be clear about what those jobs are. And we've got to make sure that happens, particularly in terms of how we would use investment and set up a mutual bank or any other form of public investment that we can lever into those new jobs. As well as the opportunities that it does present, I agree, in terms of cooperatives and not-for-profit organisations. But it can't impoverish people at the same time. And I think we've got to be really careful about how we plan things forward so that people aren't penalised by the measures that we're going to take. The other thing I think is that it is going to be challenging to private business and private business models. And I think particularly those that are becoming engaged and embedded in our public service delivery, because they're being financed at the end of the day by hedge funds largely. And their motives and their incentives, right? They're based here, they're based miles away somewhere else, but their only connection is what they see on their balance sheet at the end of a particular year. And I think that type of business model and that necessity for profit is clearly going to mitigate some of the things, the decisions that we need to take in terms of delivering public services, in particular, in a way that benefits our people, and procurement's got a clear role in that. We talked about public sector, particularly around transport, and I think it's not just going to be cheaper, it's going to be best. I think we're doing things like building, creating new forms of transport, and it's got to be the most comfortable transport, it's got to be the most attractive for people to make a positive choice to take. But I think the key principle that I would like to see in this is the role of children and young people, and I would say that with the bottom line, because it's not just enough for us to say that this has been started by the campaigning by young people, a couple of them who spoke here tonight. It's got to be a lot more than that. This is also about behavioural change. One of the key ways that we can change behaviour of adults is through our children. Children put pressures on us about whether we smoke or not, how we drive or not, the pollution that we might create when they're taking themselves to school. We had a presentation tonight from Coldstone School, which shows how powerful that can be. And I think that's really important, and we should be able to mobilise young people in that way to change the behaviour of us and adults. But I think the other thing is not just that, it's ideas and solutions. And I think I'm really attracted by the idea of citizens...
Councillor, can we one of them now, please?
And as we, regenerate the wards, I think that's really important. But I think this committee is to find a way of working with young people who can generate those ideas and solutions that I think will be really useful for us as we go forward.
Thank you. Can I now invite Mayor Anderson to conclude the debate?
Well, I'm going to take a huge amount of time in this because I think it's been really useful. I think the most important thing to remember is that this isn't the end, this is the start. Very, very clear that we go through the process, the select committee itself, but then, if you like, the work groups and the sessions. But there is absolutely no question that we're going to face some serious debate issues. And it's interesting because some of the things that I've learned tonight as well, I didn't know. Councillor Mason talked before about the call centres and new technology and the heat and the requirements and stuff, and the carbon emissions that are coming from that. They're just as bad as other things that we do. So if we're creating and saying that's what we should do, then you've got to make sure that we're offsetting that. And he's right that we should look at, you know, for instance, where we locate businesses and stuff. And I think that is also Councillor Mina said that we need to look at the process of the planning, and I think our chair of the panel has said exactly that, and that's what we need to do, whether it's waste recycling or how we make sure that the buildings and building control make sure that the buildings are fit for purpose. Mina talked about some of the things that we need to do in terms of ambition, and she's right. But the rub is that when we look at what to do those things, it then becomes a question of how do we finance them. But she's right to point out some of the things that sometimes we, for want of a better description, can't see the wood for the trees, because we've got sometimes the opportunities to do things. The Merseyside Pension Fund, for instance, is sitting on about £2 billion worth of money available to invest. So she's right, why should, you know, foreign countries take advantage of our coastline where we are building turbines, wind turbines to generate energy, but we can do them ourselves and get them built in Cavaliers and make sure that we're actually supporting the local industry. So there's all kinds of things we can do. The combined authority with gain share and the strategic investment fund money that we have can borrow money, huge amounts of money to invest, and whether that's not just a barrage, but a tidal system. So there are many, many things that we can do ourselves, and we've got to get on with it, we've got to have that ambition. But what I'm, you know, more pleased about is that everybody has come forward with ideas, everybody's come forward with solutions, talked about them. Now what we need to do is flesh them out in the debates and in the discussions that we have. We're seriously interested in Councillor Makinson, your contribution about education within the schools. You know, one of the most important things that I learned is that, you know, it's this constant rub that we face where people don't want to change. And it's not just a question of the economic impact. It's all right for sitting here is, you know, we're okay, we've got an income, and we're talking about not allowing development to take place. That creates growth. Some of the poorest people in the city depend on that growth for jobs, and that's what we're about. But at the same time, we can balance that with what we do to negate that. But I talk about, I won't name the school, but it was in South Liverpool, where I spoke to 30 students, year 6, who were transferring to year 7 in September. And I talked to them about single-use plastics, and it was the Sky campaign about, you know, what was happening to the pollution, you know, which is absolutely shocking. What we see on our screens, and all credit to Sky for doing that. But we were talking about that. But then we went on to talk about pollution, we went on to talk about air quality and the environment. And I asked the question, 30 of them sitting there all around debating, how many, you know, came to school cycle to school, 3:27 and were dropped off by the parents. I'd have then taken the kids on to drop them off somewhere else or go to work. But that's how many. And if that's replicated across the city, then it shows the scale of the problem that we face. But I'm not defeatist about it, because I remember Ron Gold and his champion together with the whole city and how we led the way to stop people smoking. And it was that change, it was that, you know, determination to make a difference that I think unites us all here. And if we do that and we focus on what we can do together, then through our kids, through the education system, through the companies, that we can make that difference. Let me just say to yourself, Councillor Crone, about Poseidon. You misunderstand what Poseidon is about. That is only one element about offsetting and allowing companies to offset. But the fundamental thing is that we have open, transparent, scrutiny available position that companies can see their impact on the environment through their carbon emissions. And then it's up to us to demand change. And if that includes making decisions like increasing business rates and business taxes, which we can do under the mail system, then that's what we'll do. And we'll make them then claim that back, but only if they offset their emissions against that. But they're the type of things that we can do. And Poseidon, in terms of blockchain technology, allows us to do that. So we'll get a presentation done of what Poseidon can offer to us and what it's about. And I'm glad today to announce that Poseidon are moving their European base into Liverpool. They have two bases, one in Singapore, and they're moving their European base into Edge Lane. And I think they will be useful, support us and working alongside us to actually make the changes that we need. So just let me just finish by saying, and it's a great debate, I think I want to thank again the leaders for being supportive of the approach that we've had in how we look at this debate. It is the start of a journey. Let's have a look at it this time next year and see what's been achieved. But remember, through the work programmes, through the cabinet member and the select committee itself, we can bring other people in from the universities, from businesses, from the trade unions, from the voluntary sector, all to help us not only understand, but to make the change that we all need to make.
Thank you, Mayor Anderson. We are now going to vote on the motion. All those in favour? I think that's unanimous, I agree. Thank you very much. Can I now invite Mayor Anderson, Councillors Kemp, Crone and Radford to come and sign Liverpool's Declaration of a Climate Change Emergency, please. Thank you. And while they're doing that, can I also ask you if everybody signs their own individual pledges, can they pass them into one of the Democratic Services, please? Thank you.
Just a couple more items of business. Item number 3, minutes of the annual City Council meeting held on the 22nd of May. Are the minutes agreed? Thank you very much. And number 4, changes in committee membership, you select committee composition and appointments to outside bodies. Councillor Ruth Bennett.
Councillor Radford can nominate somebody for one of those areas, and Councillor Crone can nominate somebody for the other area, and the last one the Labour group would take, and we'll nominate somebody. So you can either do that now if you want, or you can wait until I submit it to the
Secretary. I'm just going to nominate Councillor Joe Dunn to be the head of the committee and then go with the work streams after that.
We haven't had time to work out who you can move from a different committee at this point.
That's fine, so just submit it to the committee section.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much. That's the end of our meeting, and it was quite a long one, and it's a hot room, but just to say thank you very much for the excellent contributions tonight. And particularly from Matilda and Lowell, and the two young women that came, excellent, and I'm sure our future's safe in their hands. So, thank you very much, everyone, for all being yourselves, and I'm sure they'll last.